You know, I want to get this out of the way right up front here, and that is that there is no such thing as a perfect tractor. And I know it, I hear guys say all the time, man, that has been the perfect tractor for me. What a great tractor, okay? Well, we all kind of have our own list, our own version of what those expectations should be for a machine. And I think that, yeah, certainly there are some very great tractors out there, a lot of really great tractors, John Deere, Kubota, Coyote, whatever brand you want to have. You know, there's a great tractor for you, and it could really seem like the perfect tractor. But most of the time, we're going to be making some sacrifices to get the tractor that we want. You know, it's not going to check every single box that we have, okay? But what we do and what we kind of justify when we think we have that perfect tractor is we take the highest priority items, we emphasize those, and then the stuff that's on the bottom of the list there, we just say, eh, it's no big deal, right? So is it the perfect tractor? No. But is it the one that can meet your needs the best? Certainly. And I want to help you find that today. So in this video here, we're going to go over what makes up that priority list, the different things that you need to think about, okay? So you need to rank them, you need to write them all down, whatever the things are that you want, we'll go through it, and then you got to prioritize them, okay? There can only be one thing that's a top priority, second priority, third priority, everything's not equal, so let that kind of guide you to the right machine. And the intent is for this to be an introductory video to a whole series where I go through, is the 1 series right for you? Is the 2 series? Is the 3 series? Is the 4 series? All those machines, are they right for you? What can they do? What are they good at? What are they gonna sacrifice? Or what are you gonna sacrifice with that? And kinda, again, help guide you to the right decision, because it's a question I'm asked all day, every day. You know, it's amazing how many phone calls, emails I get from folks that are all over the country or even the world that are just looking for advice. You know, they don't know where to go. And I don't always have skin in the game, right? So I just wanna provide that information. And to be honest, I don't have time to always spend, you know, a half hour on the phone with folks kind of guiding them. So I'm hoping these videos can be a good way to help steer you towards that right decision, which ultimately only you can make. So the one thing I want you to keep in mind is do not focus on horsepower, okay? So the task that you need to do will guide you to the horsepower that you need. Don't start out thinking, my buddy told me I need a 40 horse, my buddy told me I need a 60 horse, I need a 25 horse, what do you got? Okay, you're really narrowing your window there of opportunity to the models that you can select by focusing on horsepower too much. So you, horsepower, get that out of your brain right now, okay? See you later, don't worry about it, we'll figure that out later on. But I want to make sure you know you can get your tractor from me, Good Works Tractors. You can get an attachment as well, put together a whole package. I can help with delivery and financing too. GoodWorksTractors.com. If you haven't done so yet, hit subscribe underneath the video and read through that description, okay? A lot of helpful links down there, places you can get discounts as well. Discount code GWT, 5% off. So another big consideration for folks are going to be belly mowers, you know, mid-mount mowers that go underneath the, in between the tires, you know, the fronts and the rears on a tractor. So a lot of models out there you can put those on, primarily the smaller. So if you're looking at subcompacts and smaller compacts, as you start to get into the larger compacts, that's really gonna thin out as far as the options go. So all your 1 series, your BX, you know, your B series and your 2 series and John Deere's, kind of the 3 series and the L series is where that starts to fade out, okay? There's gonna be some intermittent options there. We'll get into that more in some other videos. I've covered this a lot in past videos as well, but keep that in mind. The larger you go, the less options you're gonna have for mid-mount or belly mowers. On the flip side of that, pretty much any tractor, which is a subcompact through a compact, is gonna have a 3-point hitch and a rear PTO on it, okay? You can always put a finish mower on the back. I know it's not the same, but it's at least an option if you're looking to get your regular weekly mowing done and you have a large acreage, kind of open area where you don't really have to navigate around tight spaces and that kind of thing. A finished mower can really get the job done. Okay, so as far as trailering goes, I know everybody's not gonna trailer their equipment, but the last thing you wanna do is not have enough space or feel like you're overloading it, taking up every square inch. You know, bigger is always better with a lot of things in life, and it definitely applies to trailers. I've learned the hard way over and over. I've done some videos, quite a few videos on trailers as well, but get yourself plenty of trailer space. You know, you don't think about it, but even a little subcompact tractor with a brush hog on it is gonna take up about 18 foot of space, okay? Because they're just so stinking long with the loader on there, and then the back, the brush hog on the back takes up a huge amount of space. So way more than you think. This here is a 33 foot trailer. This works out really well for me a lot of the time, but think about that. If you're gonna go to a hunting property or a different piece of land that you have, you gotta have plenty of space for your attachments. You don't wanna overload things. It's just not going to make it a very enjoyable process, and you could end up putting yourself in a dangerous situation as well. Okay, so hopefully you can see all 3 styles of quick attach here, okay? You can see John Deere quick attach, skid steer quick attach, and then our global quick attach here. What do they have in common? They're all quick attached, so you can quickly take the buckets off of all three of these styles right here and put on a set of pallet forks, put on a bale spear, put on a snow pusher, put on a grapple. You get the idea. So don't do yourself a disservice and get a pinned on bucket. You know, don't think you're gonna just add one on easily after the fact. It's kind of a chore and kind of expensive to do. So get yourself something with a quick attach bucket, pick your system, whatever it is. The Global is gonna be more popular on larger utility tractors. This one's actually a 5 series tractor. But, you know, hey, look at this, John Deere with the Skidster Quick Attach. Okay, you can get that when you order these new or add it on after the fact. And then standard, you're gonna have a John Deere Quick Attach over here, all right? Hey, really quick, I wanna tell you about some super cool products from Mudd's Customs, okay? Backhoe grab handle, you can mount it right on there if you want to. You can get these loader mounted grab handles, they're gonna bolt right on there. I just got these things in, super exciting. Look at this, even tie downs, okay? Put them right in the front of your tractor, actual tie down points for your tractor as well. Mudd's Customs, the link is below. Goodworks Tractors, okay, you get a discount. GWT, type in GWT, get 5% off your order. Look at this, another super cool one. Step, okay, these 1025s, they don't have steps on them. Go ahead, look at that, even a built-in tie-down strap right there. And it comes with, where's it at? On the other side, so you'll have a matching set, so you have a tie-down point on either side of your machine at that point. These are mirror extensions, okay, so if you do get these grab handles to mount on your loader, you can get a mirror extension as well, that way it sticks up further. These things are built stout. I don't know if you can see this stuff, but when I looked at the pictures on Mudd's Customs website, the stuff looks pretty tiny, but it's actually all way beefier than I thought it was gonna be. Last thing, take a look really quick here. Receiver plate, all right, look at that. You have built-in tie-down points right here. You have a little built-in pinhole right here to put on a ball or whatever if you want to, and then also the receiver too. So really well thought out design right here. I like it a lot. 5% off, discount code GWT. So sometimes I'm asked a question like this: what size loader do I need to move dirt? And really, any loader is gonna move dirt, okay? So they're gonna size the bucket, the system, hydraulics and everything accordingly to the size of the tractor so that you can move X amount of dirt that the bucket will pick up, okay? And so the larger bucket and larger tractor you have, the more you're gonna move and the more efficiently you're gonna do it. But you can move dirt, you know, you can move mulch, you can clear a yard, whatever you want with any size tractor. It's just gonna be the amount of efficiency that you want and, you know, to some extent, the budget as well. However, there's certain tasks that are gonna determine minimum loader requirements that you need. One is gonna be lift height, okay? So in a good example of this would be if you need to lift and clear the side of a dump trailer to be able to dump into it. Perhaps you need to reach up to a certain height to be able to fork things off or fork them on or stack bales of hay or whatever it is. Along bales of hay, okay? So a lot of these tractors, these smaller ones, are just simply not going to lift an 800 pound round bale of hay. They're just not gonna do it. And so a tractor like this 4 series here will easily do that, all right? But a 1 series, a 2 series, those kinds of machines are not going to lift a round bale. Well, a 2 series, it can, but it's borderline. It's gonna get it off the ground a little bit and that's about it. But you really need to get to a 3 series at minimum to be comfortable, to not be pushing those limits trying to move a round bale. Okay, so everybody's favorite attachment, right? The overrated backhoe. Well, at least that's my opinion, but you know what? They're still fun to have, and sometimes you just want one. Some guys are actually gonna use these all the time, you know? So watch the overrated video that I did. Backhoes made the list. Neither here nor there. A lot of models can have a backhoe added to them. It's my opinion, at least. You know, if you're gonna get one and you're gonna buy a tractor new, get it on there, okay? If you're gonna get one on a used tractor, get a used tractor that has it on there. Don't plan on adding a backhoe down the road, okay? That's not gonna be a very good use of money either way, whether it's new or used. It's gonna be cheaper either way. If you're buying it new or used, get it with the backhoe on there already. On the flip side, you can always just rent a mini excavator and accomplish your work a lot more efficiently, not have all the thousands of dollars tied up into a backhoe, and I don't know, you're gonna come out ahead of the game probably in the long run. At the very worst, you're gonna be a wash. One more consideration about backhoes is that not every model out there is going to accept a frame mounted backhoe, which is really the best way to go about it, at least in my opinion. So for example, the John Deere 3E series, the older generation of it, is not going to accept a frame mounted backhoe. It's recommended not to put one on there. Now, when they did the redesign in 2018, I believe it was, they designed the machine so it could accept a backhoe at that point. So big improvement there, but something to keep in mind, not every single tractor out there can accept a backhoe. Although the majority can. So budget is a really big concern for all of us, okay? And I would expect it to be pretty high on that priority list. And so you're gonna have to let that kind of guide you to the decision that you make, because the budget should not really be just the tractor itself. You know, really, getting the tractor is just the base part of that purchase, you know, getting the additional attachments for the three-point hitch or the loader or whatever else it might be. That's where all the fun begins, you know. So kind of plan that ahead of time, you know, when you're putting your whole budget together. And maybe it's going to be, I get the tractor now, I get the attachments down the road as I need to. But sometimes you're getting a tractor because you have a lot of immediate needs to take care of, a lot of projects around the house, or you just move into a house and you have landscaping to do, or driveway grading, or trees to clear, or whatever it might be. So plan that ahead of time and don't push yourself to the max just on the tractor, because you got to save that room for the attachments as well. On that note, this is something I can help with on the attachments. And so if you kind of know what you need down the road, I've started doing this with a few customers. It's worked out pretty well. So it's kind of, you know, a soft rollout, right? And everything is a case by case situation. But if you think you need a snow pusher for the winter, or you want a tiller for the spring, something that I regularly carry, you know, even a set of pallet forks, for example, you can go ahead and kind of do a layaway plan, 0% interest. You know, it's equipment that I stock pretty much all the time, okay? And so if you want to spread the payments out over 3 or 6 months, you know, I just create an invoice for you. You can just go in, because I'm going to email this to you, where you can just pay online chunk by chunk. No interest, it doesn't matter to me. You know, just chunk by chunk, pay it off, and then once you're all settled up, you can go ahead and pick it on up, or we can ship it on out to you. Okay, so something else to keep in mind, all these attachments you see out here, yeah, they go on the front end, or they go on the three-point. We're going to focus on the three-point hitch-mounted ones. Every subcompact and compact tractor are going to have, or is gonna have, a three-point hitch on it and a rear PTO. So you can put whatever you need on there, the tillers, the brush hogs, you know, box blades, land planes, rear mounted snow blowers, all sorts of stuff on there, okay? What you're gonna wanna do is just size that equipment appropriately to fit the machine. So, you know, your 4 foot, 5 foot, 6 foot, 7 foot, and so on increments that you're gonna have. You don't wanna run a 7 or 8 foot snow blower on a little 1025R, for example. So it's a level of common sense, and a general rule of thumb about those three-point hitch attachments is roughly the width of the machine or slightly bigger, okay? It kind of does depend on the attachment itself, but that's a good rule of thumb. You think about it with a bucket that's on there, that's roughly the width of the machine, or maybe just slightly bigger. Same kind of premise or concept on the three-point hitch. I would also encourage you not to go too much wider than the machine, because that can be detrimental for a few reasons. One, you're naturally accustomed to trying to fit through spaces that the machine is wide. So if you have a rear attachment that's behind you, you tend to forget about those sometimes, and you're going through a narrow woodlot or a path in the woods, that kind of thing. You know, it hits a tree, it hits a stump that you don't see, that you thought, well, hey, I made it through all the way to me, everything's good here, so we'll be good to go, and then you whack something on the backside. So keep that kind of thing in mind, or even getting through gates, for example, as well. You want to have a narrow enough attachment or machine as well to get through those gates. Okay, let's talk about storage space, something that really isn't always on the radar or even in the minds of folks when you're thinking about a tractor. So number one, height, okay? So this is an 8 foot door. I fit my 4 series, my 4066R underneath here, okay? Now just barely, basically rubbing right here. There's a video on my channel I've done about that, but that's the biggest compact tractor. We're talking about subcompact and compact right here, but everything else you can fit right inside an 8 foot door, no problem, okay? Now open stations, okay? Open station tractors, you can fit any model that has a folding ROPS 4 series and under a 7 foot, a standard height garage door that most of us have at our houses. But if we're talking about specifically cab tractors, the only thing you're gonna fit underneath that 7 foot high door, the standard height garage, is gonna be a 1 series or a BX series, okay? That's it, and they're barely gonna fit, okay? But they're gonna fit underneath that 7 foot high door. A 2 series or a B series, 3 series, 4 series, you're gonna need this 8 foot opening here. And so again, the 4R is about the only one that's gonna really even come close. Everything else will easily fit underneath here, but nothing else will fit, no matter what you do, underneath the 7 foot high door. Again, as far as storage goes, this is not exactly for your attachments, but check out Tractor Time with Tim. He has a really great racking system, both in his barn and at his old house too. He's done several videos on this, of taking advantage of that space. You can really put a lot of attachments when you rack, okay? So think about that. It's gonna be a good way for you to utilize your space in your garage. A lot of us, I know I am, always strapped for space, looking for new ways to get more utilization out of the space that we have. Let's talk about cabs for just a minute as well. You're going to see some cabs right here. These are aftermarket cabs. Well, you're going to hear the Mauser cab, which is this guy right here, called a factory cab. It can be mounted right at the factory of John Deere. But when I think of a factory cab, I think of air conditioning, not just heat. And so what these cabs share in common is they are only going to be heat. You can take the doors off for the summertime so you have that airflow in there, treat them like a sun canopy. That's just fine, okay? But it's a big difference between something that has air conditioning versus something that doesn't, at least in my opinion. And so in John Deere, if you want to get something, a cab that has air conditioning on it, you got to be in a 3 series, like a 3R series or a 4 series, or you know, larger than that even. You can't get a 2 series with the factory cab that has air conditioning. Now the difference in Kubota is you can. Okay, you can get air conditioning in your B series, like the B2650, or the new LX series, the 2610 and the 3310. Sorry, I'm still getting used to those model numbers there. But something like this, this is actually an X738 garden tractor. I'm just using it as an example because I'm probably too lazy to move it. But this is a 1025R right here. Again, Mauser cab, beautiful cab. All right, heat, very nice, very quiet, very well built, but not gonna have air conditioning, heat only. All right, guys, again, keep in mind, this is kind of a general overview, just things to think about, get your mind churning, get those wheels at work there in your brain. Write down your list there of what you want, what you need, what you gotta have in your tractor, and rank them, okay? You can only have one thing at the top, second, third, fourth. Obviously, those higher priority items are going to really steer you towards the main machines that you need to look at. We are going to do some more in-depth looks at individual series over the course of time here as well. I'll put everything together in a playlist for you, too. If you haven't done so yet, hit that subscribe button right underneath the video. Make sure you read through the description as well. A lot of helpful links down there, places to get discount codes too with GWT. Make sure you check out the other videos on the channel, and until next time, stay safe. We'll see you soon. Okay, so hopefully you can see, boy. Don't end it. Oh yeah, Fortnite dances.
I don't want to do that.
Okay, guys, so, one of the other things that can shape, for the job that is made,
you're real natural, Luke.
Let me just get a bottle of Sprite. He is drinking his coffee.
This is going to extract your cyanide.
Are you imitating somebody?
Today we're talking about this little thing right here.
It has 3 holes. Actually, it has 4 holes. This one's like an alien. Small alien. You just shove it through their head, and it's just like a neck chain, and they walk around.
All right.